Oxygen transport occurs in two ways in the blood. The primary way is obviously bound to the hemoglobin in the red blood cells, and 98.5% of that, it's loosely bound to specifically the iron of the hemoglobin. The rest of it is dissolved in the plasma. So what occurs first is that the oxygen, as it diffuses from the alveolus into the pulmonary capillary, it then combines with hemoglobin, and at that point it's referred to as oxyhemoglobin, which is the hemoglobin-oxygen combination. And this is essentially the what's going to happen. So going from left to right is what happens in the lungs, and going from in the opposite direction is what occurs in the tissues, so that the oxygen can be released from the red blood cell and then diffuse into the tissues as needed. So again, that oxygen binds to the hemoglobin is the important takeaway point from that. So the association of oxygen and hemoglobin, there is loading and unloading of oxygen. And what's amazing about this is it's facilitated by a change in the shape of the hemoglobin molecule itself. And so essentially when there's all four heme groups occupied by oxygen, then the hemoglobin molecule is called fully saturated, 100% saturated. When there is only 1 to 3 hemes carrying oxygen, it's partially saturated. And this is what happens as the hemoglobin molecule makes its way from the left side of the heart through the systemic arteries. Oxygen is going to be unloaded, and we have a hemoglobin molecule that becomes more and more partially saturated, especially as it continues past the systemic blood vessels into the veins. So carbon dioxide transport is somewhat similar. However, it travels in the blood in three different ways. One way is dissolved in the plasma, and that's about 7 to 10%. Then there's some that's chemically bound to the hemoglobin, that's just over 20%. So that's significantly less than what we have for oxygen. And when it's bound to hemoglobin, it's referred to as carbaminohemoglobin. So the rest of that, the 70%, the large amount of the carbon dioxide, is going to travel in the form of bicarbonate ions. And this chemical reaction that occurs happens when there's formation of bicarbonate combining with water. The carbon dioxide combines with water to form carbonic acid, and that dissociates into the bicarbonate ion we see here and the hydrogen ion. So to see this in a graphical format, we can see the transport and exchange of carbon dioxide and oxygen here. This is the oxygen release and carbon dioxide pickup at the tissues. So it would be specifically the internal respiration. And one thing to notice here is that we have the same chemical reaction I just mentioned, carbon dioxide combining with water to produce carbonic acid, thus breaking into bicarbonate ions and hydrogen ions. Notice the same thing happens in the red blood cell, but it's faster because of this enzyme called carbonic anhydrase. So our next slide is showing the opposite, the oxygen pickup and the carbon dioxide release in the lungs. So this is what's going to occur in external respiration. The previous slide was internal respiration, and this slide is external respiration. So the carbon dioxide transport, there's the influence of carbon dioxide significantly on the blood pH. So you should be aware that when carbon dioxide increases, the pH level goes down and the blood is more acidic. So a couple important notes here are that the slow, shallow breathing causes an increase in carbon dioxide in the blood, resulting in a drop in pH. So again, that relationship is important to know, that when carbon dioxide goes up, pH goes down, and the blood becomes more acidic. Rapid deep breathing causes a decrease in carbon dioxide in the blood, and it results in a rise in the pH. So this last slide is on hypoxia. Hypoxia is an inadequate oxygen delivery to the tissues, and it can result in cyanosis if it's severe, a blood-colored look to that tissue itself. And so these are the various types of hypoxia.